Welcome to the podcast Road to Inclusion from the Atlas Alliance. In this podcast series, we'll cover themes such as disability rights, disability inclusion, the empowerment of persons with disabilities, inclusive international development aid, and disability inclusive humanitarian action. Hello, everyone, and welcome to a new and exciting episode of the podcast Road to Inclusion from the Atlas Alliance. I'm your host, Gagan Chabra, and I'm the project manager for inclusion at the Atlas Alliance. And today we have an exciting, insightful, important guest logging in from Washington, D.C., United States. Her name is Sara Minkara. Sara Minkara is the special advisor on international disability rights for the President Biden and his administration. And we are extremely elated, privileged, honored for the fact that Sara took time out from her busy schedule to talk to us. And with Sara, we will be talking about themes linked to the Global Disability Summit, what are her expectations from that. We will talk about themes linked to Sara's passion projects. We will talk about her biography. It's fascinating what kind of work she has done, and a little bit about what are the stories which she would want to share with us. So before we jump into all these interesting conversations with Sara, a little bit of visual description about myself. Right now, I am wearing a black buttoned-up shirt. I have black jacket. I have long, dark, curly hair. I have blue-tinted glasses, a red tie, and a white background behind me. And we are shooting this from the LO Media studio. So, Sara, welcome to Road to Inclusion. How are you doing?
Thank you so much, Gagan. I'm doing well. I'm doing very well. Excited to be with you today.
Oh, the pleasure is ours. We are just so excited about the fact that you're here with us. So would you mind just briefly describing yourself for all the audience members who are listening to you or who are vision impaired or blind? A little bit of your visual description would be fantastic.
Yes. So I am sitting in an office, but I do have a virtual background that has a State Department seal. I am wearing a cream slash white shirt with a cream blazer, and then a hijab, a headscarf that is brown and cream. And yeah, I think that's pretty much it.
Beautiful. The hijab sounds fantastic. I'm sure I'm visualizing you. Just to let you know, I'm blind, so it's nice to know that you're wearing that hijab. I'm sure it'll look pretty on you.
Thank you.
Yes. So, Sara, a little bit about your biography, like let the international audience who listens to this podcast and engages with us know who Sara is.
I am going to introduce myself first not in the conventional way, and then I'll lead to kind of other aspects of my biography. I am a daughter. I'm a sister. I'm a friend. I'm a colleague. I am a neighbor. I am a traveler. I'm a troublemaker. I'm an introvert. I love math. I love nature. I love horses. I love mystery thrillers. I love eating chicken. I am a woman. I am a Muslim. I am blind. I am a person with a disability, and I'm very, very proud of it. And the reason why I introduced myself in this way is because, you know, as a person with a disability, I am a person with many, many identities and many things that shape who I am and what it means to me. And I ended by saying I am a person with a disability and I'm very proud of it. And that's because my blindness has become a big part of who I am and my purpose, and shaped my career and shaped my path and shaped of how I see the world. And that's all because I was provided with an empowering supportive system, especially my mom, who pushed me, and my sister was also visually impaired, to really see our potential, our value. I won't go too much into that aspect, but ultimately that led me to starting my first organization, which was a global nonprofit focused on the inclusion of persons with disabilities in countries like Lebanon. Then it led me to starting a consultancy company that really focused on authentic leadership and inclusion. How do you create spaces where people can bring their true self forward? Because in most times and spaces, we don't bring our true self forward because we're impacted by isms, whether it's ableism and other isms and narratives. And then it led me to my new role here at the U.S. government as the U.S. Special Advisor on International Disability Rights, which I'm honored to be serving in this role.
Wow, Sara, thank you so much for such a powerful and wide-ranging and rich introduction. I was getting goosebumps when I heard the word that you said, that I am a daughter, I'm a sister, I'm a troublemaker, and I'm a traveler, because that's what we need. We need fellow travelers to travel together on this road to inclusion. And that's just so important that you mentioned the fact that you have, that you consider yourself as a traveler. So, Sara, you ended by talking about the special advisor office and the fact that you are the special advisor to President Biden, and you focus on international disability rights, and you have been such phenomenal force of nature in the activities which you have been doing. Could you please elucidate a little bit about what that department does, or what does your position entail, the special advisor position, the responsibilities?
That's a really good question. To take us, a step back, the U.S. has been a leader when it comes to, disability inclusion and disability rights by the establishment of the ADA, the American Disability Act, and in policies that really allow for persons with disabilities to live their full life and their full potential. And in this role, we are, as a special advisor, we are bringing that commitment globally. And this role was actually established under the Obama administration, and we are continuing. And the person that held that role was the amazing Judith Heumann. And we are continuing that role and that work and that growth. And ultimately, our commitment is we are there to really work on advancing the rights of persons with disability across the globe. But we're adding, we're pushing forward this specific lens of value-based inclusion. The inclusion of persons with disability is not just the right thing to do, it's actually a value for society, a value for our global community. When we don't include persons with disability, we lose out on that value and our potential. We as the world are losing out. And there's 1 billion individuals in this world with a disability. That's 1/7 of the world's population. And we have so much work to do when it comes to really addressing inclusion of persons with disability, when it comes to education and health and the climate change and all these different sectors and themes. So my team is really committed on making sure that we're working forward that commitment and that lens across the globe.
Wow. No, thank you for giving this amazing, emphatic answer, because I think that U.S. is a leader when it comes to the international development sector. If just to put things into perspective, the global budget on international development aid is approximately $150 billion every year. And U.S. ends up spending $35 billion. $10 billion goes to sub-Saharan Africa, which is phenomenal. And as you rightly pointed out, Sara, that 1 billion people with disabilities across the globe, 1/7 of the world's population. And out of this 1 billion, 80%, 800 million of them live in the global south. And that's where we have to focus on when it comes to inclusion, making sure that societies become inclusive, communities become inclusive, labor markets become inclusive. So thank you so much for the phenomenal work and the leadership which you do. And also a big shout out to the great Judy Heumann. Judy has been engaging with the Atlas Alliance for the Global Disability Summit work. And this is an honor for the fact that you are stepping into the big shoes of Judy Heumann and carrying forward that legacy.
Definitely. A huge honor to be kind of stepping in those shoes. And to your point, when you're talking about the aid that is provided globally, one thing that we need to constantly be thinking and doing is when we are providing aid to the health sector, the education sector, whatever sector, are we streamlining disability? And how can we streamline in a way that it's not seen as an add-on to the system, but it's from the get-go of the system? And that in itself is a huge importance if we want to achieve disability inclusion.
Wow, absolutely. Disability inclusion should not be an add-on, but it should be an integral element of any project, any policy, any program which is being done under the international development rubric, because it should be part of the DNA, because disability is a cross-cutting theme, right, Sara? Like, it doesn't matter your race, gender, religious background, affiliation, your national status, there's a chance that you could be disabled.
Exactly.
Yeah. We talked briefly about Judith Heumann and the involvement of her with the Atlas Alliance for the Global Disability Summit. Let's take a segue into that, because I have heard that you are also going to be part of the Global Disability Summit. So could you tell us a little bit about your involvement with the upcoming GDS, the Global Disability Summit?
Definitely. I will. So I'll be involved on the 17th in the Build Back Better session, and more specifically in the segment talking about inclusive education. So on one hand, I'll be kind of talking a little bit on the importance of inclusive education when it comes to, you know, COVID has really shed light and on the gaps when it comes to different aspects of our system, including the education system. And it's kind of in many ways furthered the marginalization of persons with disabilities. So when we are building back better, and that's something really important for here in the US that we're focusing on, how do we make sure we are looking at, as again, disability from the get-go and from a value-based lens, and making sure that when we are building things up, building back better, we are inclusive of persons with disability. And then I'll also be having a dialogue with President, former president of Tanzania, which will be exciting. And he's currently the chair of the GPE Global Partnership Education.
Wow. I'm just so stoked to listen to that conversation with, and specifically on the theme of inclusive education, because education is the currency of our knowledge economy. If you want to get into employment, if you want to have a meaningful life, then you got to get educated. And one of the major challenges for children with disabilities, almost 240 million of them, is that they don't get access to inclusive education. The curriculum is not inclusive. The teachers are not prepared to have them into the same quote unquote regular schools. And that's a huge challenge. But so I am so excited about the Building Back Better panel, which you would be part of. So Sara, if I may ask you, you have mentioned this point about the value based or inclusion for persons with disabilities. What do you mean by that? Because I think that's such a powerful phrase.
So when we look at, you know, the issues around disability inclusion, right, we unfortunately look at it and understand the issue from a technical lens, and we provide technical solutions. Let's make sure we provide X solution, whatever the solution is, right? But if you really dig deep into why are persons with disability not fully included into our society, the core reason behind that is the narrative towards disability, which is either, you know, they're less than, they're different, I feel bad, incapable, or as we call it on the other hand, the inspiration porn, oh my God, like, you know, they're or living their life, oh my God, you know. But we haven't gotten to a point in society that we say, I see you with a disability, you have value as a person, I want to make sure I include you. So because I want to make sure I include you, I want to make sure that the system is accessible to make sure I include you. But I want to include you because you have value, I want to benefit from your value. And if the system truly believes that from the get-go, then the system is going to develop policies and programs and procedures from the get-go that is inclusive and accessible for everyone. But that narrative is not yet prevalent, if that makes sense. So that's why it was, the inclusion of persons with disability is a value for all of us. It's not just the right thing to do.
Oh, absolutely. You're hitting the bullseye right now, when you're talking about, in other words, ableism, it's so poignantly and so eloquently said by you that either the narrative is on the side of charity, pity, sympathy on one side, that I feel sorry for you, that you have a disability, or you are made into this inspiration porn that, wow, it's so amazing that you're able to get up from the bed, go out and have a job, go out and have a family and be an amazing mom. So yes, and this narrative has to change. And one of the major and most persistent challenge which people with disabilities around the globe encounter is this attitudinal barriers. So phenomenal. If I may ask you, Sara, you're going to participate in the Global Disability Summit. So what are your expectations for the summit?
Well, you know, I'm excited to see what commitments are being put forward from different governments. And I think this, you know, this Global Disability Summit as a follow-up to 2018 is amazing. It's coming at a really important time. You know, as we've gone through COVID the past few years, the world is, people are tired. They're exhausted. They've been through so much. And I think this GDS is going to be an amazing opportunity to come and share what has been happening the past few years, what commitments can be put forward to really make sure we're really hearing these challenges and we're putting forward commitments for progress. You know, and the fact that, you know, inclusion, disability is at the should be at the forefront of governments' minds as we are building back better. So this is going to be an exciting kind of summit coming together to really share these commitments to move forward.
Yes, absolutely. You are so right that there are so many important commitments which are being brought up. For instance, those linked to strengthening the organizations of persons with disabilities, those linked to making sure that you could operationalize inclusive education, make sure that the healthcare system is inclusive. And what you rightly said, that COVID pandemic has kind of exposed these fault lines and shown us that how fragile our bodies are, how fragile our systems are, how interconnected our societies are. So we cannot just shy away and say, okay, that this problem exists in only one part of the globe and I could just cordon off. No, the problem will percolate and will spread across the rest of the part of the globe. So it's so important to kind of stress that disability inclusion is happening now, and this post-pandemic period, this GDS is going to kind of lift that issue up of commitments linked to inclusion of persons with disabilities. If, Sara, I may ask you this, that is there any specific commitment which or specific outcome which you would want to realize from the Global Disability Summit?
I mean, so a couple things. We, the U.S. government, have made commitments, which we are, you know, thrilled to kind of be sharing this during the Global Disability Summit. And through both the State Department and the USAID and Administrator Samantha Power will be the keynote, which is, you know, very remarkable in terms of really bringing forward this, amplifying the importance of disability inclusion. And a lot of our commitments really go around revolve around this whole point of, even within our work, we want to streamline disability into all of our foreign policy and our foreign aid, right? The streamlining aspect is really important, and the cross-sectional cutting aspect is really important. And we've made commitments around issues around peace building, gender violence, climate change, humanitarian aid. And ultimately, if I take a high level view, right, ultimately our goal is we want to be streamlining disability into all of our foreign policy and have disability be seen as a value to our foreign policy. One of the things that we are focusing on as the State Department in the coming years is around accountability and building capacity, around promoting disability inclusive democracy, since democracy is an important priority for the administration, and making sure the disability inclusive element is part of that work. Advancing human rights in countries of crisis and conflict. And then the fourth is disrupting the narrative surrounding disability to move towards a value-based narrative, which we've been talking about the past, many minutes. And that's something that we are, you know, working on bringing that forward across the administration and globally. So there's so much work to be done. And I think the GDS is coming at a perfect moment on all of this.
And it has a very good steward and a supporter in you, Sara, if I may say so. The fact that you are joining the Global Disability Summit, you are here in this podcast, is so valuable because the narrative has to change, and it has to start the change of the narrative towards greater inclusion, towards greater mainstreaming of disability issues has to happen from here, right here. And as they said, you know, if not now, then when? If not you, then who? Right?
Exactly. Definitely.
Absolutely. So it was music to my ears when you said about a disability inclusive democracy and also focusing on a disability or persons with disabilities in the cases of humanitarian crisis and conflicts. The reason why I say that is because Norway, for instance, spends almost $4 billion every year on international aid, which is one of the highest per capita spending, because Norway is a small country with approximately 5.3 million people. But out of this $4 billion which is being spent, less than 3% is disability inclusive, and a tiny, tiny fraction of that, some say even less than 1%, is that for, spent on people with disabilities in cases of humanitarian crisis or wars and conflicts. So I think that this priority, which you are foregrounding, which you're accentuating from the American side, it's extremely important because we need to help our brothers and sisters with disabilities if the crisis takes place in Afghanistan or Ethiopia, the crisis taking place with armed conflict.
Yes, exactly. And I think when it comes to crisis, there's, you know, the different element of, you know, a lot of times as we're planning for anything, making sure disability is part of the conversation. When a crisis happens, how do we make sure disabilities is part of that aspect? When we're in negotiation and peace building, we want to make sure disability is part of that aspect. And then the rebuilding and the post-conflict, how do we make sure disability is part of that aspect, right? It needs to be streamlined, and it needs to be done in a way that, again, not the right thing, not just the right thing to do, but there's value. There's value in this.
Absolutely. Not just the right thing to do, but there is value when it comes to disability, an intrinsic value, because at the end of the day, we all are human beings who have equal human dignity, equal human worth, and we all are striving towards human flourishing. And persons with disabilities are persons first. So, of course, we have to focus on that aspect. Thank you so much, Sara, for mentioning that again. If I may ask you, from a thematic standpoint, is there any specific thematic area which is very dear and close to your heart, which you're really passionate about?
I mean, I think something that you mentioned earlier is, you know, I will say the first and foremost when it comes to disability work is understanding ableism and understanding how we are part of creating the narrative in society when it comes to disability. And understanding also how do these narratives impact how we see ourselves, right? And ultimately, it's both sides of the equation. And I think when we start within and understanding that aspect, and I'll give you an example. Like as a person with disability, I've dealt with a lot of ableism, and I'm assuming you have too, right? How do we make sure that narrative doesn't impact how we see ourselves and how we see our potential and how we see our value? And to the reverse as well, how do I understand what narratives I'm creating in society? And how do I make sure I'm delaying my assumptions and I'm trying to see the person in front of me for who they truly are? And when we really embark on that journey of understanding narratives in society, we are then able to then, when it comes to education and employment and the health sector and society at large, we will become much better at being more inclusive, if that makes sense, and bring out more of the value.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Like if you would be able to see me, you'll see me, you know, smile and nod in absolute affirmation to whatever you said, because that is the crux of the issue, that if we want to realize inclusive societies, if we want to build back better after the pandemic, if we want to create thriving democracies, then we have to include people from we have to appreciate diversity. We have to understand that we cannot be prejudiced towards or discriminate against people just because of the fact that they have a disability. Because think about this, that I'm sure like people have told me so many times that I don't look disabled enough. So Or if what are you holding in your hand? Is that a white cane? And I'm like, yes, it's a white cane, but I also use it for a fashion statement from time to time. So you understand, because the idea is this, that there's just so much ignorance around disability, because people are not comfortable talking about disability, and that leads to this propagation of a narrative of either the victimhood or the inspirational porn. So yes, we definitely need to take bold strides on that. And is there any specific initiative which you plan to do as part of the special advisors to President Biden's office to combat this, to combat ableism and to promote the narrative of inclusion?
There's definitely a way, and I want to answer that question. But to your earlier point on this whole ableism, I do want to share a story actually of an individual I met. His name is Kyle. He's actually an amazing person. He's a mountain climber and he's paraplegic. And he told a story once of, you know, when he was young, his grandmother would take him with her to the supermarket, and, you know, he's paraplegic and 3 years old at the time, and people would walk by and they would be looking and people feel either awkward or they would turn away or whatever it is. And the grandmother would actually come up to people and say, "Hey, do you want to say hi to my grandson?" And that interaction, right, in itself is what we need. It breaks down the barrier. Yes, the person might feel awkward in the beginning, but the whole point is my grandson is like anyone else. He's a kid. And then the grandson as well is getting this narrative that, yes, I should be interacting. I am part of society. I'm not going to hide away. I'm not going to be shy, ashamed of who I am. And that in itself is so powerful. We need to have these dialogues and these interactions, but we need to have it through this concept of curiosity, through a lens of compassion. I want to get to know you, but let me get to know you without assumptions, but through a lens of compassion, and vice versa. That's what a lot of what I see in a lot of my work in the past and now, people are sometimes afraid of saying the wrong thing, or afraid of not knowing, or they are like, oh, instead of disability, differently abled. I'm like, no, I am a person with a disability. I am blind. Don't do I am blind. But what I need to do is just change the way you're thinking about my disability. So to answer your last question, the reason why one of our main priorities we put forward is disrupting the narrative surrounding disability to really push forward this value-based narrative. We're working both internally within the administration and externally of bringing forward this value-based narrative, and really make sure having these dialogues and conversations, and making sure that we're bringing forward disability into all spaces, and saying, look it, talk, let's talk about it. Let's not avoid the elephant in the room, and let's talk about it from a value-based narrative. So.
Wow, like one thing which just literally blew my mind away was what you said about the framework of curiosity with compassion. That is just so, so, so vital, because often people are so shy, people assume so much, people have such misconceived notions and misconceptions that they would say, I dare not even approach this individual because he or she has a disability. And that's not a conversation starter. That kills the conversation. So it's so important to kind of what you said, I'm not differently abled, I am disabled, and I'm proud to be disabled. And you could talk to me as you would talk to any other individual, because I'm a human being and I have the same amount of human dignity and human worth the way you have it. So let's talk. This was just phenomenal, Sara. And I'm just so happy that you're underscoring this aspect, because often people, what you said, it's an elephant in the room, and people say that, no, are people with disabilities supposed to be there in a conference on diversity and inclusion? Yes.
Exactly.
Are people with disabilities supposed to be in a conference which talks about poverty reduction and equity? Yes. So like these conversations, and there are these institutions which have kind of said that, no, perhaps they should not be there. And what you said, we have to make sure that we say the word disability and we say to the individuals or the organizers that we belong in those fora and in those conversations, and let's have a dialogue about it. Wonderful. So Sara, if I may ask you, if you have a piece of advice to the organizers of the Global Disability Summit, the partners, the members, the Atlas Alliance, what would that be?
A couple things. One is, to this point that we were saying, as we move forward and as the Atlas Alliance is, it's doing its amazing work, the more that, this value-based narrative can be fully integrated, which is the work of Atlas, right? Alliance. And the more that it's really embodied and embraced by everyone, that's really important. The more that, the fact that you and I are persons with disabilities talking about it is so important. We always talk about nothing about us without us, right? But there's someone that told me another phrase that remove the word about us, just nothing without us. And I think that was actually a very powerful statement. Yeah, nothing without us. We should be part of every single conversation. This is more in general. I think when we're talking about development and whether it's about disability inclusive development or all kinds of development, I always say human-centered design, journey mapping, understanding, curiosity and compassion, really understanding what communities are going through and really trying to bring forward those value-based narratives. And then finally, I will say this to anyone and everyone, really realizing that we all have the power within us to create an empowering space for others. We all have that power to actually be part of that solution towards inclusion. And it starts actually by anyone and everyone that you meet, we actually delay our assumptions of any assumptions that we might have and get to know them for who they are. That in itself, when we do that with our colleagues, with how we're with our beneficiaries, if it's our organization, with whoever we are, if we really approach it with that lens, there's so much power to that.
Wow, phenomenal. The fact that you said that we all have the power within us to empower others is such an important statement, because many times persons with disabilities are told by the society that they are, what you mentioned, Sara, a few moments ago as well, that they are incapable, they are dependent, they are supposed to be taken care of. And that leads to the internalization of those values. And then the persons with disabilities start to feel that. That's the internalized ableism, right? And when we start flip the coin and say, no, you have the power, you have to be the change which you want to see in the world. If you want inclusion in the world, disability inclusion taking place, you start with you, yourself. So one thing which kind of stuck out for me was I was reminded of is the fact that the word inclusion, if you think a little deeply, it starts with the word I, but it has us at the center. And that's just so important to kind of stress that persons with disabilities, nothing without us has to be realized only when persons with disabilities get a chance to be part of the conversations taking place at all levels across different parts of society. Thank you so much, Sara, for this. Is there any nice, endearing anecdote which you want to share with our international audience who's listening to you, who would be listening to you and learning from your insights? Because I know you do a phenomenal job with disability rights, disability inclusion, but beyond the corridors of the White House, something nice that you want to share with us?
I mean, I don't know if this is an anecdote of what we're looking for, but it kind of summarizes what we've been talking about when it comes to value. It's a story I share a lot, especially because of how much education is really important. So I was in grad school. I was in a classroom full of 100 students, and everyone had their name cards. And the name cards allow for people to better interact, engage with one another. So in the beginning of the semester, I said, can you please say your name when you're speaking so I can know who's talking? And that will allow me to better participate. And the professor was like, no. I was like, what do you mean, no? Am I right? He's like, the way you phrase it is that they are doing you a favor if they say their names and make the classroom accessible. But actually, by them saying their names, making that class accessible for you, you're able to participate, you're able to contribute, and they're able to benefit from your contribution. So actually, it's a value for them. They're not doing you a favor. It's actually a value for them. And I was like, huh, okay. And for me, to be honest, I never thought about it that way until then. And, but you probably can relate to this. It does feel at times when I advocate for myself or advocate for access, or because we do have a lot of obstacles sometimes for access, you feel like you are a burden. You feel like you're asking for too much. You feel like, you know, but ultimately that professor and his statement was an important reminder for me, but actually, no, you know, this is by us having access and being included, it benefits the system that we're in.
Absolutely. I think you are hitting the nail on its head that we bring tremendous value to the society with all our experiences. And like right now, people are living with COVID pandemic, they are being isolated, but ask persons with disabilities, with severe disability, how to deal with isolation. People are having mental health problems. They are having breakdowns. But think about persons with disabilities who have been living like that for many, many years. So there is a chance for persons with disabilities to kind of communicate that to the rest of the society and say, there is a way out of this pandemic. There is a way out to create an inclusive society. And what you said is, it's so phenomenal, Sara. And I'm so grateful for the fact that you did not take a no for an answer. You kind of challenged and asked the question, and then you pushed the professor. And it's just so wonderful that we have champions like yourself who promote disability inclusion at the topmost echelons of the society and the government in power. So if you want to follow Sara Minkara's work, she's a special advisor on international disability rights for President Biden. She started her work in October last year and is filling big shoes of Judith Heumann. If you want to engage with us at the Global Disability Summit, please go to globaldisabilitysummit.org website. There's a hashtag with regards to the Youth Summit, which is having a lot of traction in social media. Go to that hashtag. It's called as GDS Youth. 200 million young people with disabilities, that's what they are talking about. And if you want to engage with us at the Atlas Alliance, go to the Atlas Alliance website and follow the GDS globaldisabilitysummit.org website for all the updates. Sara is going to be speaking on February 17th, having that fantastic conversation. It'll happen around 1400 hours CET, that is the Oslo time. And Samantha Power will be speaking on February 16th, a keynote address, a great champion on disability rights. She's the head of USAID right now. Very important speakers. So Sara, once again, extremely grateful. I am so happy that I got this chance to talk to you. I wish you could have been in this studio together, and I would have liked to take a picture with you with your beautiful hijab and my long curly hair. That would be a nice picture.
Definitely. Well, someday we'll make it happen. Thank you, Gagan. I really appreciate you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Sara. Bye from Oslo. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much for tuning into this podcast episode. I hope you found this conversation engaging, enlightening, and a little bit entertaining. And if yes, then I hope you get a chance to follow the other episodes as well. And please subscribe and share the podcast series Road to Inclusion.